In just over a month's time, we have Ukraine's presidential elections, preterm presidential elections, because they were supposed to be held in March of 2015. They were brought forward because of regime change and the fleeing of Viktor Yanukovych from Ukraine. There's no doubt that Russia would like very much to either prevent them or postpone these elections, and so we can expect more provocations from Russia between now and the presidential elections. The last thing that Russia wants is a president who is viewed as legitimate by people inside Ukraine and recognized as legitimate by the European Union, Canada, US, and of course OESE, Council of Europe. So we can expect some. There's very likely to be a second round going through to the middle of June. Ukraine's only ever had one presidential election where there's been just one round. That was in December 91, which was won by Leonid Kravchuk. Every other election has had two rounds. Petro Poroshenko, being the very arrogant person he is, believes he can win in the first round. I don't think so. I think he and his main competitor, Yulia Tymoshenko, will go through to the second round 2 weeks later. And so we'll know sometime in the third week of June who Ukraine's president will be, and it's likely to be either Poroshenko or Yulia Tymoshenko. From the other 20 or so candidates that have been registered, you have a very large group, probably up to about nine, from the former ruling party of regions, which, by the way, still has the largest parliamentary faction in the Ukrainian parliament. It's halved in size since the crisis, Euromaidan crisis, and Yanukovych fleeing, but it's still the largest with about 100 deputies. But it's no longer a monolithic political machine, which it used to be, and about nine or so, maybe 10 candidates have emerged from that, showing that there are splits and divisions, and personal ambitions have overtaken the party of regions' unity and discipline. And this is a mixed bag of people, from the more reformer types such as Serhiy Tyhipko to very odious people such as the former energy minister Yuri Boyko, part of the gas lobby, and for some reason the former Kharkiv governor Mr. Dobkin, who is on criminal charges for separatism, was made the official candidate of the party of regions. One would have thought they would have chosen somebody with a cleaner face, a nicer face, like Tyhipko. But from what I hear in Kiev when I was there, that's not possible. Firstly, because Tyhipko is not a Donetsky, he's not one of theirs. Secondly, he couldn't be controlled by people like Rinat Akhmetov, the kingpin boss of Donetsk region. And so they chose Dobkin, who can be controlled, even though he's not going to receive probably even 5% of the vote during these elections. And the only thing that he is going to do, he's going to be competing with somebody who's even more odious, probably Mr. Tsaryov, who is also now probably under criminal charges for aligning himself with the Eastern Ukrainian violent separatists. From the opposition side, we have, or from the former opposition side, we have also a large group of people, which is surprising. Why is it surprising? Well, anybody who doesn't get through to the second round loses their deposit given to the Central Election Commission. And that's about 2.5 million hryvnia, which is about $200,000. So there's a lot of people with spare cash lying around. The former opposition have still not understood the need for unity. You know, it's rather strange that Poroshenko is asking Tymoshenko to drop out when there's a whole range of other candidates in there who have zero chance of winning any popular support from two or three nationalists, such as Dmytro Yarosh, leader of Pravi Sektor, a nationalistic group that emerged from nowhere during the Euromaidan, and Yarosh is somebody who officially was unemployed, but he's managed to find $200,000 for the deposit. The Svoboda leader, Oleg Chernobok, the Ruch leader, and the leader of the Ukrainian People's Party, which used to be led by Mr. Kostenko, and the former defense minister, Anatoly Gritsenko. So together, those five nationalists and former opposition leaders will lose $1 million between them in terms of deposits given to the Central Election Commission. One would have thought that $1 million would have gone better being given to the National Guard rather than being wasted in such a way. But of these candidates, the most likely, the race is certainly one between Petro Poroshenko and Yuli Tymoshenko. Vitali Klitschko dropped out of the race during a rather bizarre meeting that was held in Vienna during the same week as the Department of Justice of the US unveiled criminal charges against Dmytro Firtash, the leading guy in the gas lobby. So it was a rather strange time. The timing was rather strange for this announcement to be made public that Firtash supports Petro Poroshenko and that he had asked Klitschko to drop out. I wondered when I was in Ukraine, why was it that Klitschko didn't tell Poroshenko to drop out? Because Poroshenko's the old face and Klitschko's the new. And I was told by a well-placed Western journalist in Kiev, I won't mention his name, because it was said confidentially that Firtash said to Klitschko, I'm happy to tell Poroshenko to drop out. If you return $30 million I've invested in your political party, UDAR, Ukraine Democratic Alliance for Reforms, and in the airtime, which includes the airtime I've given you on my channel, Inter. Klitschko wasn't willing to return that money, and therefore he dropped out in favor of standing in the Kiev mayor elections, in favor of Petro Poroshenko. Now, Poroshenko has a reputation in Ukraine of being very skupy, very tight with his money. So I'm pretty sure most of the election money that he's using is Mr. Firtash's. Why then, I asked in Ukraine, why was it that Poroshenko permitted this announcement to be made public? Didn't he want a secret meeting in Vienna? And the answer for that, I was told, was that, well, it's not really a question of Poroshenko. Poroshenko may have wanted a secret meeting, but Firtash wanted it public. He actually wanted the meeting public, and maybe he wanted it deliberately in the same week as the criminal charges were unveiled against him, because he wants to show to Washington that he has high-level support in Ukraine, that the candidate with the leading poll ratings, Petro Poroshenko, is the candidate that he supports. Now, Western diplomats in Ukraine will rather laugh at this. They think it's rather amusing that Dmytro Firtash believes that somehow his ties to politicians in Ukraine will assist him in his criminal case in Washington. The two are completely separate. And the FBI will and Department of Justice in the US will not be taking into account which alliance that Firtash has in Ukraine with which candidate. Nevertheless, Klitschko dropped out. That's a shame. I think it would have been a rather interesting race, for example, if Klitschko had stayed in, because then he would have gone to the second round with Tymoshenko. Tymoshenko would have found that very difficult to win, because she was the old face facing the new face, Klitschko. At the same time, Klitschko burnt himself during the Euromaidan. You see, the Euromaidan, in many ways, was a testing ground for him as a politician. And he didn't come out very well. I mean, he needs to go and train. And maybe the training he can get will be as mayor of Kiev, maybe, if he wins, because there is plenty of competition there as well. But certainly, he didn't come across as a great speaker. He didn't generate authority amongst the Euromaidan protesters. And in fact, when he came back from the EU brokered roundtable negotiations on the 20th of February, the crowd booed him on the stage. So I think all of these factors also played in. It wasn't just money. These factors also played in him dropping out. Now, with Poroshenko staying in the race, this means that Tymoshenko's chances of potentially winning the election race have improved, because the second round won't be a race between a new face and an old face. It will be a race between two old faces. What, though, has become rather bizarre in Ukraine is that Poroshenko's ratings have been relatively high and Tymoshenko's have been relatively low. Now, we should always remember that Tymoshenko, in every election, her and her political force, Batkivshina, Byut, bloc of Yuli Tymoshenko, their popularity was always camouflaged in some ways. It was always higher than what opinion polls showed. And a lot of that's to do with the fact that she has support in rural and small towns, which opinion polls don't reach. So if, for example, the polls say she has 15%, the real level of support for her would be 20-25. So nevertheless, Poroshenko's is higher, and it is rather strange because Poroshenko's biography is actually more checkered than Tymoshenko's. None of these politicians in Ukraine have clean slates. Tymoshenko's, it's a fact, it's a long time ago, 20 years ago, she was linked with Pavel Lazarenko, who of course went to the US and was in prison for a number of years. But pretty much from 2001, when she first went to jail for a month, her political stance, which is sort of a on the radical wing of Ukrainian politics, if you want to call that anti-oligarch wing, her position has been pretty clear, and she hasn't really wavered. I mean, she was a radical during the Orange Revolution, she was a radical in government when she was able to, because Viktor Yushchenko was against it. And in the case of Poroshenko, that's different. He is somebody for which the word flip-flop was probably invented. And that's why it's rather odd that his biography has not been scrutinized to the same extent as Tymoshenko's. But I guess that's going to happen during the course of the next month, and maybe especially during the second round. Petro Poroshenko is associated with very odious political forces, with the Social Democratic Party United of Ukraine, led by Viktor Medvedchuk. He's one of the founding members of the Party of Regions in 2000-2001. And then he's involved in a variety of activities during the Viktor Yushchenko presidency, which don't earn him much credit. To this day, he has very bad relations with Renat Akhmetov, which maybe works in favor of Tymoshenko in Donetsk. And the reason for that is that Petro Poroshenko is seen by Akhmetov as somebody who was pushing to imprison one of his allies, Boris Kolesnikov, who was a close buddy of Akhmetov's in business and politics from the 1990s, and who went to prison in 2005 for 4 months. Before he went to jail, Poroshenko allegedly went to see him. This was reported in the Ukrainian media at the time. And there must be something in it if the relations between Akhmetov and Poroshenko are still bad. Poroshenko went to see Kolesnikov and said, you can forestall and not go to jail if in exchange you give me X, Y, and Z, some enterprises, some media assets and such like. Kolesnikov told him where to go and instead went to jail for 4 months. So the Donetsky have very long memories, and that's going to be a problem for Poroshenko trying to get votes in Donetsk, if there is going to be an election in that region, of course, with the separatism taking place there. Also, of course, Poroshenko is very much associated with the fall of the Tymoshenko government in September 2005, only 8 months into the Orange Revolution, which wasn't a good sign for Ukraine. And the following year, because he refused to stand down and let Alexander Moroz, the socialist leader, become speaker in the summer of 2006, he refused to do that. Moroz then defected with his socialists to Yanukovych. They created their own parliamentary coalition. And so out of the blue, Yanukovych became prime minister in August of 2006, when it should have been Yulia Tymoshenko, because of the opposition orange parties, it was her party, her bloc, that came ahead of Our Ukraine. So that was again down to his arrogance and the defection of leading to the defection of the socialists. So there are many factors there. And of course, he's had a long history of relations, very good relations with Azarov, going back to the Party of Regions, when Azarov was the first leader of the Party of Regions and the head of the state tax administration. Poroshenko was a member of the Azarov government for 1 to 2 years. So I think all of that is going to come out in the election campaign, and so that which will mean that the gap between Poroshenko and Tymoshenko will narrow. I think he will get more support in the first round, but he certainly won't win the first round, which will take it through to the second round, which will probably become more dirty. It is a rather strange election because it's like a repeat, it's like going back in time to 2005, 2006, where in effect you've got two wings of our Ukraine still at loggerheads. One wing, which was always allied to Tymoshenko, the kind of anti-oligarch, if you want to call it populist, it's some people do, I don't think it's the correct phrase, wing closely tied to Tymoshenko. And then you have the so-called pragmatic business wing of our Ukraine, led by Yuri Yakhanurov, Petro Poroshenko, and the so-called dear friends, as they were called in Ukrainian. These were allied more to the party regions. They were very much in favor of grand coalitions with the party regions. And that split in our Ukraine was there all the time, and it led to massive infighting between the two groups. In effect, you have this race, this election race, is a repeat of that, a repeat of the fight between the kind of radical anti-oligarch and pragmatic business wing of the party regions. And therefore, it's not surprising that the gas lobby is heavily investing in Klitschko, Poroshenko, who are allied here, and because Tymoshenko is their worst nightmare. The gas lobby have been able to work with every Ukrainian leader who's been happy to become involved in corruption in the energy sector, including Yushchenko, and the only leader that's got in their way was Yulia Tymoshenko. So little wonder the gas lobby has been investing in Klitschko, first of all. Well, back in 2010, it was investing in Arseniy Yatsenyuk, then with Klitschko, now with Poroshenko. So the race is going to be on, and it's one of the reasons why the Ukrainian strategy, or military strategy, anti-terrorist strategy in East Ukraine has not been as heavy-handed as many people expected, particularly in the Ukrainian diaspora, is because of the fear that anything like that would provoke the Russians coming in, provoke a wider wider conflict, lead to human losses, greater human losses, and that would prevent the holding of the presidential election. So the presidential election race is something that is seen as key in, as it were, turning the pages over to the new Ukraine, and hence why I think Vladimir Putin would love to have them cancelled or postponed. Thank you.